Hallelujah. Once again, we come to the presence of God. As you know, we are meditating the scripture in this series of messages. In fact, we have given the title, Jesus' Feet, that you know that we are sitting at the feet of Jesus. Last episode, we were really reading a passage from book of Genesis, chapter 1. Now, I would like to read a passage from the book of Exodus, the second book of Bible, chapter 1. And this speaks about the people of Israel who came to Egypt and how they were growing. 1 verse 7 says, "But the people of Israel were fruitful and increased greatly. They multiplied and grew exceedingly strong, so that the land was filled with them." So they were fruitful, that's a word which is used. So they had many children and strong children. It's not just many children, but strong children. But when they came, when we read Deuteronomy chapter 26 verse 5, "And you shall make response before Lord your God, a wandering Aramean was my father, and he went down into Egypt and sojourned there, few in number, and there he became a nation, a great, mighty, and populous." This is a confession of a Jew before God, that when we came to Egypt, we were not a people, great people and things like that. We were only few people, few in number. We know that it is these Jacob and his sons and their families, that's all. Even in Exodus chapter 1, verse 1 onwards, "These are the names of the sons of Israel who came to Egypt from with Jacob, each with his household: Reuben, Simeon, Levi, and Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, and Benjamin, Dan, and Naphtali, Gad, and Asher. All the descendants of Jacob were 70 persons, except Joseph." Joseph was already there. So 70, 75 people were there, that's all. But now they are not hundreds, not even thousands, but lakhs of people, many, many thousands. So they were 70 people, and gradually, you know what happened? The people who came, the first generation, they died. Joseph died, verse 6, and all his brothers and all the generation. But the people of Israel were fruitful and increased greatly. Joseph died and other people died, but the next generation was more, and next generation was more and more and more. More than 400 years, the people were growing very fast, very fast. And the problem, they were multiplied and grew extremely, exceedingly strong. That's the reason why I say they were not just in number, they were strong, so that the land was filled with them everywhere. They were living in a place called Goshen. Of course, all over the place, you know, it is all full of Hebrew people. And that made the Pharaoh sleepless. Pharaoh is the representative of enemy or the devil in our teaching. Pharaoh is not devil, but what I say, if we consider the people of Israel as that represents the church, if it is, that's why I said we are here trying not just to learn the literal things of the Bible, but we are asking Holy Spirit to give us the spiritual insight that will help us to get transformed. That's why I say that the people of Israel represents the church, and the enemy or the king of this world, devil, is called the god of this world, right? So he never wants to see that the church is growing, the people of God is growing, and he wants to suppress them. And he will act very shrewdly. That's what we see there. The Pharaoh says, "Now there arose a new king over the Egypt who did not know Pharaoh," who did not know Joseph. Did not know means what Joseph did for Egypt Everybody knows that is in the history, but did not have a regard for Joseph. And he said to his people, behold, the people of Israel are too many and too mighty for us. Too many and too mighty. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, lest they multiply. And if a war breaks out, they join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land. So this is the fear of the enemy. So the enemy want to destroy the church or the people of God. So they are acting very shrewdly, in a crafty way. Satan is a crafty fellow. And he will not, many times he will not act directly. He will play some game with whatever capacity he has. Now Pharaoh is the ruler of the people of Israel or the ruler of Egypt. So he can even persecute people. Likewise, even though we see many kings or the rulers, human rulers, maybe they are good people, I don't know, but basically devil will work through them and persecute the church. So devil thought, if we persecute the church, then certainly church will come down and finally there will be no place for the church. But that did not happen. That's what we say. We see here, therefore they set taskmasters over them to afflict. Verse 11. Afflict them with heavy burdens. They built for Pharaoh store cities, Pithom and Ramses. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied. This is the problem. The more they were oppressed, the more they were multiplied, and the more they spread abroad. Exactly in the history that happened. Persecution was one of the tactics of the devil, started from the very early church. You know, even when the church started, there were persecution. You know that even in Acts we see James was killed and Peter was in the prison and many of the people were in prison. Stephen was stoned to death. Persecution started just after the church started. You know, persecution also started. But that didn't affect the church. All these afflictions made the church grow more, like in the life of the people of Israel. When they were afflicted more, they were growing more also. And they were wondering what happened. Why? Even when we persecute people, more children are born. And they are more strong. So the tactics that we were doing, it is not working in a proper way. So when one of the tactics of the devil doesn't work properly, he will consider something else. Earlier persecution was his weapon, but many places he failed. Take the case of Germany and Russia, Romania, China, and many Buddhist countries. Everywhere persecution was there, but you know, church also was growing. But in these days, there is no such persecution. We are not seeing that much persecution. So what we can expect, he has changed his policy or something like that. And what is his policy now? Now he is trying to, intrude into the church and try to make us more compromising. Maybe they will say, we will help you. Nowadays, you know, even the politicians want to help the church because they will get votes. Not that they are loving Jesus and things like that. Don't think like that. So that is their tactics. So Pharaoh also understood that even if we oppress the church, it is increasing. So let us act more shrewdly. I told you, devil want to intrude into the church. As somebody said, in these days, Satan is not persecuting the church, rather he is joining the church. He also will come and sing and dance and he will do anything. And he will say, we will give you a new idea. That's the reason why in many of our meetings, we are adopting everything that is worldly. Here also, that is the same thing, it's happening. He called, that's what we say. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and the more they spread abroad. And the Egyptians were in dread of the people of Israel. So they ruthlessly made the people of Israel work as slaves and made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and all kinds of work in the field. In all their work, they ruthlessly made them work as slaves. Then the king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, they said, persecution is there, but that doesn't work. So he called the midwives. And he said, one of whom was named Shifra and the other was Pua. And he said, when you serve as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a son, you shall kill them. But if it is a daughter, she shall live. Okay? See what he says. You go to the Hebrew people, Hebrew women who are in labor, and tell them, we will help you. Because you do not know how to handle it. We are here to help you. So it's the same thing that is happening in churches today. The world is coming. And they say, oh, the church music, it is very dull. So we'll do one thing. We'll adopt all kind of rap so that we can attract more people. And we'll help you. And in these days, we have heavy metal. You know, when you are using heavy metal in church, more young people will come. So we will help you. And the politicians are coming. We will make your center a pilgrim place. We will help you. I'm wondering why all these people want to help the church. Huh? They are offering help, right? You get me what I say? We are ready to give you money. Don't worry. They are ready to give everything to help the church. But what is their intention? That is my question. They are coming and telling that we will help you. But what is in their mind? Or what motivates them to come and help? Pharaoh said, you go to the people of Israel, to the wives of people, and when they are in labor, you just go and tell, we will help you, but if it is a son, kill. So why the world is coming to help the church? They want to kill the newborn. You get me? That's the only thing. With all this music and with all these lighting and this and that and all worldly things. Everything is worldly in the church today. And we are saying, what is wrong in that? We take the best. These are the talents of the people. So we are just allowing them to express their talents. But you know what is happening? The devil has a clear plan to kill the newborn. He wants to kill the people who are born in the church. Especially mighty people. Strong Christians. Devil is not targeting weak Christians. Devil is not targeting, because he knows that even otherwise, you know, those who are coming to the church for namesake, Satan is not bothered about that. These days there are many places we have music, concert, and we call it praise and worship, a lot of things. Devil has no problem. He also will come and dance with you. Because they are Christians only inside the church. When they go out, they are with the devil. They are with the devil. They worship the devil. Inside their heart, it is devil. Once an old woman, she went to the church to pray. She was alone. And there was a school adjoining to this church. And in the school, there was competition of fancy dress, like disguise themselves with some other dress. Some people are coming as beggars. Some people are coming as, kings. Some people are coming in different costume. And one boy, he came and he dressed like the devil. But you know, his number was last. So he had a lot of time. He was putting all the paint and everything in his body. So he was little not comfortable. So he thought just going out. And he went out and there was a small drizzling, a rain. All of a sudden, he went inside the church. He didn't want to go to the church, but because of the rain, you know, he went inside the church in the costume of a devil. And this, our mother, old mother, she was praying, Jesus. And when she opened the eyes, she saw the devil. And she was afraid. She was afraid. And she was telling devil, you know, I come to the church, but still, even though I pray to Jesus, in my heart, it is you. You know that, right? This is the situation of many people. They call themselves Christian. They come, play music, worship, everything is there. But who are they outside the church? That is the question. And the devil is coming not to help you. You need to understand. The world cannot. The world says that we will help you to get more children. That is why in conventions and crusades, we are using all worldly things. In these days, you know, we are using all worldly techniques to attract people for our camps. And there was a flyer of a youth camp, and one of my friend was just reading it to me and said, what happened to your youth organization? You know, you cannot miss it. That is the title. Beautiful campsite, reputed band is singing, lot of fun, games and mouth-watering food. Come to the camp. You cannot miss it. If you see such a flyer, we will not wonder, because this is what is happening today. We are trying to get help from the world, or the world is offering help, like the midwives. But you know, they are sent by whom? They are sent by Pharaoh, the king, or the lord of this world. And we need to be very careful. Very careful. And the midwives came, but they fear the Lord. But they have a king. And after some time, but the midwives feared God, verse 17, and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but let the male children live. So the king of Egypt called the midwives and said to them, why have you done this? And let the male children live? The midwives said to Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not like Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them. You know, they said, the women of the Hebrew women, they are very special people. They give birth to the child without the help of a midwife. That is the speciality of a Christian. A Christian is giving birth to a newborn or a new believer without the help of the world. The word which is used there, they are vigorous. What we need is vigorous Christians who will give birth to children without the help of the world. The world will ask you, okay, we will help you to get more children. Your church will be full. If you have, you know, there are some churches who put a movie first, then music, then preaching, so that they can attract more people. Once when I was in Sri Lanka, I was attending a church. The first half an hour, they were showing the highlights of a cricket play where their church was playing and they won the match. So that was the first half an hour in the church service. You get me what I say? But a vigorous Hebrew woman will never depend upon the Egyptian midwife. So this is a big question. Do we need the help of the world to give birth to spiritual children? But the problem in these days, we are not producing spiritual children. So what was the speciality of the Hebrew people? They were only 70 people went to Egypt. But in no time, in few hundred, 300 years or less than 400 years, you know what is happening? It's a great multitude of people. And what is the speciality of the people? They were strong in number. They were very vigorous. They were strong people, mighty people. And even the enemy was fearful. My dear friends, do we have this kind of vigor in bearing children, spiritual children? If you are a true Israelite, it is your responsibility to see that you are bearing children for the kingdom of God. How many children you have born in the past years? That's a question. How many children were born to you? Do we have that kind of a kind of passion for bearing more children, spiritual children? Bring more children to the church, not with the help of the world. If you are using the help of the midwives of Egypt, you know what is going to happen? They will kill the male child. They will kill. So that is why new birth is not happening in the church. And even if it is happening, the children that are born are weak Christians. I ask you, my friends, let us be vigorous. Let's be vigorous. Let's see that we are bearing children. When I say these things, ask yourself, do I bear children? If you failed in this thing, you failed in the best thing or the first thing. Because God wants His children to be fruitful. How can you be fruitful? You are becoming fruitful when you are producing people like you. A jackfruit tree is fruitful when it produces jackfruit. A mango tree is fruitful when it produces mangoes. Likewise, a Christian is fruitful when he is producing Christians. If you are a true child of God, you will produce true children of God. That is your responsibility. That's what we see here. The people were multi. They But the people of Israel were fruitful and increased greatly. They multiplied and grew exceedingly strong. Make strong Christians, not just feeble Christians. Strong Christians. And if you expect help from the world, you are a failure. You need to be vigorous. Tell the world, I do not need the help of an Egyptian midwife, because I am a child of God. I have the power to give birth to the children. Be vigorous, very vigorous. That is our main target, main mission in this world. All the time we want to see that we are desiring for spiritual offspring. What is our desire? What is our dream? Spiritual offsprings. We need more children, spiritual children. Produce spiritual children, strong children, without the help of the Egyptian midwives. Never allow the world to enter into our church. Never allow the worldly pattern to share gospel. You have the power. You are vigorous. And you need to be vigorous to bear children. What is our desire? What is our passion? Is it spiritual children? We just pray so that God will help us to bear more children, producing children in a very vigorous way. God is looking for spiritual offspring. Close our eyes. Our Heavenly Father, we come to your presence. When the church was born, there were very few in number, but they were vigorous Christians. So in the first century itself, millions of people accepted Jesus. Lord, we also want to be vigorous Christians. We want to produce spiritual offspring. That's our desire, that is our mission. And Lord, we want to do it with your help, not with the help of this world. We are not looking for the Egyptian midwives. Lord, help us to be vigorous and give birth without the help of worldly techniques. Lord, let's produce more children, more and more, not feeble Christians, but very strong Christians. And we need to be fruitful. We need to multiply, O God. Help us, Jesus. Devil cannot hinder us from bearing children. We have your strength and power and authority. Lord, help us to bear more offspring, spiritual offspring. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.